All right. Okay. So we're going to, this is basically a simpler version of the Mandalorian helmet. We have to set up our image planes, and we're going to model. It's going to be very basic. It's not a hard asset to model, but you know, we can, the hardest part is actually doing the substance work, because we try to do displacement work in substance to get the little ridges on the dumbbell, but I will show you in a second here. So we're going to go to our front view, and we're going to attach our front image. So to do that, we go back to view, we're going to select camera, and we're going to go to our attribute editor by hitting Control A. And we're going to scroll all the way down to environment, and we're going to create a new environment, which will take us to our image plane. We will just set it to, you can leave it like that, it's okay. We will just pump in our image plane here. If you guys want, you can download the dumbbell images from the Centennial website. Under the intro to 3D lectures, there's a dumbbell project. Should be under intro to 3D. You can download the images. But I kind of want you guys to just follow along and just see what I'm doing here. Let's see. Documents. Everybody got so quiet. Good Lord. Did I scare anybody about the 3D stuff and the map painting? I hope I didn't. I don't think it was. I think it's okay, right? Everybody? Yeah? Okay. All right. I think it's fine. You guys will be fine. It's only first semester. I don't mean to put too much pressure on you guys, but you know, I want you guys to succeed. That's my main goal here. So I just assigned the image of the dumbbell in our perspective view here. I mean, in our front view. And now I will go to the side view, and I will do the same thing. So just make sure you're in the side view. Select it. How do you put the picture? Okay, here, I'll show you again with the side view, okay? So I'm just gonna maximize the side view by just hitting spacebar. If you go to view up here and just select the camera, if you do Control A, you'll get your attribute editor opened up. Sorry, here, let me rip it off. I usually don't like having it connected, sorry. So hitting Control A will get you the attribute editor. And if you scroll all the way down while the camera is selected, so make sure you have the side camera selected, and you can usually tell by the tabs up here. In the side shape, not the side, but the side shape, you're gonna scroll all the way down to environment, and you're gonna hit create where it says image plane. And when you do that, you'll get like kind of like a X on your screen, which is basically just like an image plane, but it's empty. And where it says image name, we're just gonna hit the little folder, and we're gonna go to where we downloaded the file, and we're just gonna open it up. And as soon as you open it up, it shows up in your viewport. All right. And now we'll do the same thing. I've kind of already resized these, so they should come in and fit nice as they are, which looks like it. So we're just gonna kind of move them aside right now. And maybe, you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna go to we're gonna look at our front view. We're gonna select both image planes, the front and the side in our perspective. And we're just gonna move them up together until the dumbbell is sitting at on the surface here, on the ground plane, right? So you can tell the ground plane in the front view by the darker line, okay? So you can see the horizontal one is our ground plane and the vertical is our vertical plane. But yeah, so you can see now that the dumbbell should be sitting perfectly on our ground plane, even in our side view. All right. So to start modeling this, it's a very simple asset, but you know, there's different ways of doing it, but like you can reinforce it by yourself. You can bevel it. You can model the numbers and just have them in there, or you can do a displacement or a normal map in Substance Painter. There's a lot of ways you can do it. I know Dimitri kind of modeled everything, which is fine and great, but it's a pain in the butt to model all this stuff as geometry. So you kind of, you know, overkill yourself. The easiest path is usually the right one, or the simplest path, sorry. So you know what, I'm just going to answer that question kind of, I don't know who asked that part-time job thing, but I think in semester four you guys will get co-op, like you have to go out and get co-op placement, right? So I think there's a lot of companies out there that offer that. I think we at WeFX, I think we're doing it this year, like right now, just because we needed people. So we hired students. They are getting paid, so it's awesome. You get paid to work. But so I'm gonna talk to the higher ups and see if we can maybe do like a co-op program and bring some people. But depending on what we need at the time, if we need 3D, if we need comp, if we need lighting or map painting or whatever. So it's based on our needs, but yeah. But there's a lot of companies out there that kind of offer it. And one more thing I want to do here is I kind of moved it up so the dumbbell is sitting on the ground, but the awesomeness of this image, it gives you the center point of the dumbbell. So I'm just going to scoot it over until our image is kind of centered the best we can. And remember to make your gimbal bigger and smaller. You can use the minus and plus keys next to backspace. I kind of use it just so it gives me a little more precision while I'm moving it. Okay. So first thing we want to do is just kind of make like a hexagon in this shape, right? It's a very easy asset to do, not too complicated here. So we're going to go here and we're just going to make a cylinder. All right. Super simple. We're just going to rotate it. If we go to our channel box and layers here, we're going to rotate it 90 degrees in Z. And we'll just go to our inputs here and just change that to, how many sides is here? Is there six? So six. All right. Maybe we got to just rotate it another 90 degrees. And for this purpose, I'm just going to move the pivot to the bottom section so I can just snap it flush onto the ground. So I'm just going to hold down D and V and middle mouse click on a pivot. And I'm just going to bring it, and I'm just going to hit X to snap to grid. And I'm just going to snap to grid only in Y. just to bring it up, okay? So now we have this generic shape here. Now we can just, we can go into our side view and we can just scale up our object until it roughly lines up with our image here. And I just hit 4 to go to wireframe. And I'm just gonna try to even it out here. Let's just scale it up. So you can tell probably my image is probably a little stretched. I don't think these dumbbells are off shape, but that's okay. We'll just get as close as we can. We can kind of squeeze our image plane if we wanted to really fix it. That's a cool part. What you can do here, so you can see how I selected my image plane, but we can't see our wireframe object. What you can do is, the simplest way to kind of shade the wireframe is under the layers here. If you select an object and if you click on the first, or it would be the last box here where it looks like a plane with a sphere on it. If you click on that, what that does is it makes the layer and adds the object to it. So now we can turn off visibility. I kind of went over this in the first classes, but the cool part is this box over here, if we click on it, we can change the layer, the name of the layer, and we can also change the color. So I'm just going to go with yellow here. So now we can see our outline of our wireframe nicely. And you know what? I'm just going to squash the image plane a little bit. And maybe I have to move it up just a hair like that. It doesn't matter. We've got it pretty close. Okay, so now we've aligned it to our side image. Let's align it to our front image. So now you can see how like wide our dumbbell is. And even though this image looks like it's a front view, it's really not, because we could see the sides of the object. So it's not a true orthographic image, but you know, we're just gonna use it to get our shape. It's not gonna be perfect, but it will be close enough. And you can even see the image is kind of like, when they took these photos, it's not perfectly aligned like the dumbbell, because it lines up perfectly with the side, but the front, it's kind of off here. So it's okay. We're just gonna kind of use it as a scale reference for the top and the bottom. And for the width, we'll just kind of bring it over the middle and just scale it in, just so we can get the proper thickness of the center of the dumbbell, okay? So we're just focusing in on just this center part, not these extruded parts here, okay? So there we go. We've got this going on now. So what we can do now is, we can start to extrude and play around with the shape a little bit. I'm going to extrude both sides a little differently. I think the one side I'm just going to delete, and we'll extrude using edges, and this side we'll extrude using faces. Okay, so let's go back to our perspective view, let's go to our, it's kind of funky. Let me switch. So on the side here, we have all these little buttons here, and basically this is kind of like changing your layout. So I sometimes use the two vertical panel here. So I'll usually like to kind of work my one orthographic view and one, my perspective view. So in my perspective view, I can do my selecting, And then in my other view where I have to be a little more precise, I'll do my extruding or something. All right. So here, I'm just going to right click and just extrude face. And I don't remember, I don't really like using the thickness and stuff. It's, you can, there's nothing wrong with it. It just sometimes if the object is off center, it doesn't work perfectly. So I kind of like, just scaling it. I like just hitting W again and just moving it from the center, or hitting R and just scaling it from the center and not using the extrude gimbal. So I'm just kind of get it as close as I can. Okay. And basically, that's pretty much it. We're not going to worry about the perspective. We're only using it for basically the dimensions of it, or rough dimensions of it. And okay, so on this side here, we're going to do the same thing, but we're just going to go into edge mode, and we're just going to select all the edges, and we're going to extrude edges. I'm going to hit W, so I'll just extrude from the center. And I will move it over and I will extrude, and you can see the difference. Just because the camera is not perfect, it looks like this side is a little smaller. So what I'll usually do is I'll extrude it here. Just to show you real quick with edge extruding. So I'll usually extrude it. Once I get it to the right depth or something like that, I'll leave it. And what I'll do here is I'll double click the edges, and I will use, why isn't it going away? Okay, there we go. I will use the fill hole, and I will usually fill that up, and I will just create one edge right across like that. The simplest solution to do this, instead of doing one side and extruding the other side, is just extrude the one side that you want, that you think the thickness is correct. Basically, just this angle is wrong in the image plane. But what we can do is, remember, if you go to insert edge loop, hold on, sorry, insert edge, come on, do it. Or sorry, no, the multi-cut tool, my bad. I want to show you both ways. So the multi-cut tool, so if you hold down control and shift, we can insert edge loop right down the middle, right down 50%. All right. And if you want, you could also insert edge loop, which is basically the same thing, except it's its own tool. And the cool thing about this is if you do it like this, you can go into the properties of the, well, it's not split edge tool, but it's more of like a split ring. So if you go into the split ring tools, you have to exit the tool, sorry, and go into object mode. You can manipulate the weight of where this edge is. So if we set it to 0.5, it's going to be right down the middle. If we set it to 0.7, it's going to be 70% over on one side. And we set it to 0.3, it's going to be 30% on the other side. Okay. So it's kind of a cool thing. I always like to do this. So the cool thing now is we've put an edge loop right down the center. So why is this helpful? Because now we can mirror this and we can get both sides identical. So what we'll have to do first is we're going to just go into component mode, faces, and we're just going to select all the faces on the side that we don't want, and we're just going to blow it away. And right now our pivot is on the outer edge, but I want to move it to the inner edge, so when we mirror, it's going to mirror on this axis. Okay, because if I mirror right now, let's say I mirror And before I do that, I'm just going to delete my history because it does get kind of annoying when your history gets built up. So I'm going to go to edit, delete by type history. And I'm also going to freeze my transform. So it's kind of zeroes out all my channels here. We try not to do that too much on a very, detailed object. Or remember when I mentioned that if your object is rotated and you freeze transforms, you kind of lose the object gimbal. It won't work anymore. It kind of stays in the world space. So watch, see if I rotate this and I freeze transforms, my object gimbal is automatically oriented the same as my world space. So I can't actually move the dumbbell along this face's axes. I can't move it that way anymore. We do have a workaround by holding down W, left clicking, going to axes, custom, set to face. And we can do it this way, but that's only temporary and you have to keep doing it. And I showed you guys this tool before where we can manipulate the gimbal and we can set it to different orientations, okay? So let's just finish this off. I'm just gonna delete or freeze transform while it's still pointing up straight. I just wanna, if I duplicate the object, just shift D, and I go to my red gimbal here, which is my X. So if I go to scale X and I just go -1, it's gonna mirror based where this pivot is. So that's not right. So I want the pivot to be over here. So I'm gonna hold down DV, middle mouse, move the pivot over, duplicate it, and put -1 in X. And now I have, the dumbbell still lines up with the center, but I get the proper proportions according to what we extruded on this side, okay? Now the object is not combined. There's two separate objects, okay? There's two different ways of doing this. Maya has a mirror tool, but the way I'm doing it right now is the manual way, okay? With the other side, or I'll show you again with the mirror tool, but right now I'll show you this way. So we duplicated, we have two objects. You can see them right here, one side and the other side. So if we select both of these and we go to mesh, there is a combine feature. So when you combine it, you can see it took the shape node out of both of these and it turned it into one. All right, and usually when you do that, you're left with a transform. And sometimes when you group things and move it, it kind of looks like both objects are moving at different speeds. So we typically like to delete our history. All right. So we've merged our objects, but if I double click on the faces of one side, it's still not selecting everything. And that's because even though we've combined the mesh, we haven't actually merged the two pieces of geometry together. And this is where that merging vertices comes into hand, okay? I'm gonna show you a cool heads up display here. So if you go to display, show, display, heads up display, and we go down to poly count. Okay, so I'm selecting the center, all these vertices, and technically there should only be 6, but it counts 12. So this is your total for your whole object and the total for your whole object and the selected column, okay? So if I drag select over this one vertice here, it's going to show you that there's two, one from one side, one from the other side. That is how you could also tell if when you're creating something and if you've merged something with something else, or you've extruded something, but you haven't pulled the extrusion out and you have geometry overlapping itself, if you drag select over something and you see that you've only selected A, one vertice, B, one edge, but it's showing you two vertices or two edges, then you'll know you have geometry overlapping itself. So we're just gonna select them all. We're gonna right click, merge vertices, and we're gonna go to the merge vertices option box. Yeah, sure. I don't know why the scale is off here on this Maya. But if you go, when you hold shift right click, you'll see merge vertices at the top. If you go over it, you get a couple options. You get target weld, which is like dragging one vertice on top of another vertice and it'll merge. Then you have merge vertices to center. Basically, you can select any vertices anywhere and it'll merge them and even out the spacing between them. So if they're equally distant apart and you merge to center, they'll come right into the middle, right? Okay. And then the third option is merge vertice. So I kind of use this one. This is like when you have things overlapping, it's almost like merge to center, except when you go to the option box, you get a threshold or a tolerance, okay? So the higher the tolerance, the further away the vertices can be away from each other, okay? The lower the tolerance, the closer the vertices have to be together before they will register a merge, okay? So usually if the vertices are perfectly on top of each other, you can leave the threshold as it is. And if we go apply, you'll see it change to one, right? If we put the threshold really low, I don't think it'll work, but it might. If we hit apply, it still does it. They're still too close. Okay, so let's try it. So let's say the vertices were separated like that and our threshold is really small. If we apply, okay, it still works. let's see what the threshold is. Let's say it's this far apart and it still works. Okay. Let's see if we set it higher. Maybe that's what it was. No, still works. I think our scene scale is really small. So it's not gonna be affected. But if you're making something really big, it still works, but whatever. But it's the threshold. So if you notice, if you ever model something and you select the two vertices, and the threat and it's not merging, you will need to adjust your threshold. And the only reason I like using this one is I can select everything and I can hit apply at once and it will merge everything together. All right. Except it didn't. Why not? See, now it's not working on the other side. Point one. Let's see. So I have eight vertices. I should have six. There we go. All right. Let's see. And I move this one over. And if you ever do this where you move one edge and it's not in line with the other ones anymore, we can do the hold down V to snap to point. And if we only move in the one direction, which is X, we're gonna snap it to this point's location in world space. So watch, as you see. So we're only moving in the one, if we were grabbing the center and doing V, then yeah, we could snap it anywhere. But because I was holding down V and snapping in only one axis, it basically gave me that nice alignment that I had before. Okay. So that's one way of merging. And honestly, the only way I merge, I don't use the mirror, but I'll show it to you anyway. So we're just going to delete this real quick. Our pivot is in the center because the object was merged. And we're going to go to mesh and we're going to go to mirror and we're going to hit mirror. And there you go. This is why I don't like using Mirror, because the default settings are bullshit. So cut geometry is always on. I don't know why. I don't know why it's on by default. And you have to change your axis position where our object is not at the origin. So it's not at world space. It's off. And we're trying to mirror it on its own pivot, remember? So we have to change from world to object. And now it's going to mirror properly. And you can also set an offset, and you can also set the axes that you want to mirror on. Okay. So we're mirroring on X, so that's fine. And you have the same things. You have merge borders, which is basically merging the vertices from the two halves, and you have a threshold. So the higher the threshold, again, the further away the vertices can be, but you have to be careful with this, because if you have a lot of edges really close to the object that you're mirroring, if you have too many edges really close like this and you mirror, sometimes all these edges get combined together, okay? If the threshold is too high. And that is how we mirror, or in Maya, the two different ways. So we'll just keep it like this. It looks like it's fine. You can also go into sub D mode to see if it's working. There's no tearing, no nothing. So we're good to go. What we're gonna do now is we're just gonna get rid of these triangles here, because you know me and triangles, I don't like them. And I like quads, so there you go. So now when we bevel.
What did you press to make the quads?
I didn't press anything. What I did was I selected the edges and I hit Control Delete to delete those edges.
Okay, thank you.
Just because I know just from looking that this is my quad, and I just need to delete these two edges to make that quad polygon, right? Yeah, that's all I did. So I'll just delete those and I have my quad shape. So with beveling, one thing with beveling, you have to make sure you have everything selected that you want and need to be beveled. If you forget an edge, it becomes a pain in the ass to go back and fix it later, okay? So beveling is very simple, especially on an object like this. We're gonna select all our edges that need to be reinforced to keep our shape from turning into this. We're gonna deselect our edges on flat surfaces, because we don't need this edge down the middle to be beveled, because it's not doing anything. It's not reinforcing anything. It's not on an exterior edge of an object or exterior part of an object. So it doesn't need to be reinforced. Same thing with this edge. It's on a flat surface. It doesn't need supporting. All right. So we're going to just shift, right click, and bevel is off to our right here. And once we bevel, we'll see the object gets a little funky here. So we're going to play with the fraction. And the fraction is basically the tolerance between the reinforced edges, okay? Or the spacing. So if you want a softer, wider, bigger bevel, you can have the number bigger, right? If you have to look at your object, like this table, it looks sharp, but everything has a bevel. Everything is rounded. Otherwise you run your hand on it and you'll cut yourself, right? Everything is rounded to a degree. So it depends on what you're making and what you want it to look like, okay? So here, segments are basically the amount of curvature that you want on the inside of those two edges that are made automatically. I usually just change it to two. I usually only need, you only really need basically the the inner edge and the two outer edges. So basically, it's like we would reinforce this the way we would normally do it by just inserting edge loops, right? But the cool thing with the bevel tool, it kind of creates like a little arch with it. And you can see the arch with the more bevels that we add, or the more segments that we add. And the cool thing about this is we could leave the object like this and we never have to sub D it. We never have to hit 3. We never have to sub D it at render time, just because it is a hard surface object. And because we've added so many bevels, we've got that nice softness already built into it. Okay. So that's one way. There's, you could leave it like this, or you can, we can open up the bevel again and we can take the segments back down to 2, sorry. And you can hit 3 and it looks the same. The bevel is not as like pronounced, but it's still there. All right. The one thing I want to caution everybody with using bevels, especially on like more complex geometry, is every time you up the segments, it changes the pattern of the edge loops in the corner. Okay. It's really nitpicky, but it becomes a problem sometimes when you add too much. You'll start to see that little triangle. Okay. There's no reason that we need so many bevels, but you know, sometimes we'll just keep adding them and the triangle will get smaller and smaller and until it's not as noticeable, but it gets kind of annoying having to work with this, like especially if you have to delete an edge and you have to recreate that kind of section. So I just want to show you, hold on. So if I go back to 2. Okay. I'll show you by, and another cool thing, let's say you beveled something, and this only works if the bevel is still in your history or in the inputs of the object. What you can do is if you select the name, this bevel or poly bevel one, and you control C, you copy the name. In Maya, we have all these little tabs collapsed, but on this one here, this input menu operation baloney thing that I've never used in my entire life, you can change this to either rename, which I use all the time to rename objects, or you can change it to select by name. So if I type this name up here, this polybevel one, and I hit enter, it selects the operator. And now if I hit delete on the keyboard, it will delete that bevel from my object and from the history, okay? So it's kind of a cool thing where you can kind of go backwards. You can undo it, okay? But as long as it's still lived in your input history here. So another thing I want to show you here is, let's say I selected all my edges, I deselected all the edges that I don't want, but I forgot to select certain edges and I just went bevel. Okay. It's happened to everybody, happened to me. And then I do my segments. I do my 2 segments. And then I look over here and I'm like, oh, this looks awesome. And then later I'm like, oh fuck, what did I do over here? So you can try to select, all the edges here again. Okay. And you can see the funkiness that it creates over here. Because it auto tries to solve the bevel in certain corners. Some corners it leaves it open, some corners it makes these weird triangles to kind of finish it off, but it doesn't work. If you think that you can just go back and re-bevel it, it's you're going to have a hard time because it's not going to work the same way anymore. Okay? It's not going to look like this. And you having to try and sit there and recreate it is going to be a problem. So if this ever happens and you deleted your history, then I would say delete half your object and mirror it again, if you can. If not, you kind of have to sit here and fix the bevel yourself. So you're going to clean those edges up. You're going to insert an edge loop on the other side. You're going to select the faces that you need to select. On the flat side, you're going to extrude, but you're not going to push out. You're going to go to scale and you're going to push in, right? So now we've kind of made our own little bevel here, and we're going to have to kind of close it off. So we're going to have to merge these. Okay. So this is just a what if moment, okay? What time is it? 8 o'clock? Okay, we're gonna finish up soon. So you can see we still have the triangles. We can try to recreate this, but it's never going to be exactly the same, but that's okay. We're going to try to get as close as we can. And to do that, we're just going to delete these. And we've got something pretty close. It's not perfect, but it's the same. All right. So that's one way of doing it. And what you can do, the one thing about beveling and then creating a bevel yourself, you're going to notice is, you can see that this edge is still sharp, this edge is flat, this edge is flat. But on the other side, you can see how it's kind of created that arch, right? And that's why bevels are pretty good, because they kind of give you that. But hold on, why did it open that? Sorry. I just want to go through. We'll just do this. We'll take a 10-minute break and then we'll get back. We'll do the main handle part, and then we'll just go around and do one-on-ones. So what we can do here is we can kind of do our edit edge flow to kind of change the flow of it. It does fuck things up a little bit. All right. And I'm saying this, I'm doing all of this just as a what if moment. Okay. So you can go back on this and you can take a look. And this will mostly work on any surface that you have where you've forgotten to do a bevel. But usually try to be very meticulous when you're using bevel to make sure you've selected all the edges that need to be selected. Okay. Otherwise, you will run into some issues. Any questions on this part? No? Everybody's good? Okay. All right. Let's do 10-minute break. You guys go pee, eat lunch or dinner. Sorry. Yeah. Resume recording. Okay, so we're gonna make the handle now. We're just gonna make another cylinder. I turned on this feature here, which is wireframe unshaded, just so I can see my wireframe while I'm working. You can also go to shading, and you can turn it on here. Okay, there's also X-ray mode, which kind of makes everything kind of transparent. It's kind of annoying, but you can use it, which is this option right here, this little box here. Okay. What I want to do here is I want to line this up to the center of this, but I can't do that because I don't have like another edge loop going vertically so I can get the center pivot. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go to multi-cut tool and I'm just going to hold down shift so it puts it at 50% in the middle, and I'm just going to click it and I'm going to hit enter. And right now I got a vertice. It's there by itself, but I'm just going to use that as just something I can snap to. So if I hold down V now, I can just snap it. Or if I want to get fancy, I can hold down C and middle click on the curve, and I can slide until the object stops, which means it's hit the vertice, and that's the center point, okay? I can also go into vertice mode now and select that one stray vertice that we put on the edge and delete it, okay? Because we don't need it anymore. So now if we go to our front view, we have our handle in the center, and we're gonna scale it down from the center until it kind of aligns with the profile of our dumbbell here. And it's super simple. We're just gonna go into vertice mode and we're just gonna select all the vertices on the other side of the dumbbell, go back to our front view, and we're just gonna move it until it's in line with the origin world space in the center. And to do that, we're going to hold down X to make sure it's perfectly aligned to the grid and just move it along just X. And you can see it's snapping to the other increments on the curve there, but we want it to snap to the center, and I wiggle around to make sure it's on there, which it is. So now when we mirror the one side to the other side, we can mirror off this center point right here at the origin, okay? So what I'm gonna do next is I'm gonna delete, and one quick thing. Yes, we'll have to move our pivot to the origin now. So D and X to snap, move pivot and snap to grid. That's what X does. And one quick thing. Would you mirror an object with faces on the inside like this? Huh? No, because we don't want faces in our object. So if we mirrored, I'll show you what happens. Well, first of all, cut is on, which is not what we want. We can leave it on world space and X, but when we subdivide it, look what happens. Okay? It's not what it should be, and the object is not working correctly. We never want faces on the plane that we're mirroring from, okay? Let's just undo that. So I'm just gonna select the middle because that's what I wanna keep. I'm gonna shift select the rest of it, and I'm gonna delete the ends. Anytime we mirror, we always want to make sure it's opened, okay? Because we need these vertices here to weld to the vertices that we're mirroring from. And if there's faces in the middle there, it's going to cause problems, okay? So we're basically, what we're going to do is just follow the image. We can see that we have a hard edge here. So It goes flat and then it goes down and stops. So we're gonna add another edge ring here. And then it goes up and stops around here somewhere. And we're gonna add another one there. Now we're gonna go to our perspective view and into edge mode, in component mode, we're gonna select this ring and we're gonna just hit R and we're just gonna scale it down until we get it roughly where we want it. Okay. And then that's pretty much it. Now what we can do is we can select these edges. Whoops. We can select these edges. We can bevel them reduce the fraction a little bit just to bring in the bevels a little bit. Change the segments to maybe 2. And it, when you subdivide it, it looks okay. For the end here, you know, usually there would be a hole in the dumbbell where this would go into. We don't need to do that because it just, it's going to overcomplicate the object. So the way I usually kind of cheat it when I create this kind of stuff is I will select the edge ring at the end. I will extrude it out a little bit, like into this. So you'll see if we go on the inside, we'll see that it's going through. And I'm just going to scale it down a little bit. And then I'm going to select this edge. You can see there's like a little, it's tapered down. I'm going to select this edge and I'm going to bevel that too. And now when I subdivide it, let me show you better. So if I turn off wireframe and I'm going to turn this button on here, what this does is kind of fake ambient occlusion. And what ambient occlusion is, it creates like a fake contact shadow. So like, you know, when you put your phone down, you can see like a little dark shadow around it. If it's sitting on something lighter, it kind of makes something look like it's sitting on the surface. Okay. And you could see that we kind of get that fake look of the object going inside the dumbbell. If you want, I'll do a small video at home about beveling, like cutting things out of other shapes, which is a little more complicated, but I'll show you that. And honestly, now we just do the same thing we did with the weight on the end. We just delete our history. We freeze our transforms, modify, freeze transforms, and we can name them. This is dumbbell end, and this is dumbbell handle. And what you can do now is actually you can select both these objects and you can group them by doing Control G and naming. You can name the group like dumbbell underscore GRB for a dumbbell group. And now we can mirror it. We can actually mirror the group. Oh, I didn't duplicate it, sorry. We can duplicate the group and mirror it. And then we can just select the two ends and combine it. Or instead of duplicating the two groups, we can just do one at a time. So we had the dumbbell pivot at the center of it because we mirrored it because we wanted both ends to be the same. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna move the pivot back to the world space origin. We're gonna delete history, and we're just going to duplicate the object, and we're just going to scale it in X to -1, and it puts it perfectly evenly on the other side. And with the handle part, we can use mirror just to make it easier on ourselves. We're going to turn cut off, we're going to mirror in X, and we're good to go. So if we look through our front view here, we can see that everything is good. It's, you know, the camera, the orthographic view image that we use is not perfect, but it got us there. So you can see it actually when we mirrored it, we actually got it pretty close. So there you go, dumbbell ready. You can UV it now and you can take it into Substance Painter and finish it off. For the UVs, I only showed you guys how to UV a box. I didn't show you how to do nice UVs. So, okay, maybe next class we'll do the one-on-ones. Who wants to do one-on-ones today? Okay, all right, I'll try to get some one-on-ones. I just want to do the UVs really quickly. I'll just show you. So I showed you guys some of the tools in the cereal box, but I'll show you guys this now. So the one thing with UVs is, I don't know if you remember, but when we see the bright white lines, basically those are the border edges, the edges on the outside of this mesh, okay? So you can see, because we used a cylinder to start with, so let's say I make a cylinder here. You can see, this is what the UVs of a cylinder look like. You got the two caps and you got the body of the cylinder in the middle. So when we modeled it, we basically have the body of the cylinder here. If we go into wireframe, we can see it, but we also see this giant box here. And what that is, it's the extrusion. So anytime you extrude something and you use a primitive shape, it makes these large boxes. Basically, every time you create new geometry, it has to create new UVs, okay? So the easiest way to kind of UV a cylinder, like this, like our little dumbbell handle here, is if we go to the UV settings, we have different kinds of auto mapping here. I'm just gonna tear the window off here and I'll show you. So the fastest and easiest that people use is always automatic, because it just automatically does it for you. And most of the time it does something decent, but I just feel that you can do it better yourself. Sometimes if you're in a rush and it's a background object, honestly, go for it. But what I like to do is sometimes I'll use camera projection. And what I'll do next is, hold on, let me make this window a little smaller here. What I'll do next is I'll select where I want the seam. So let's say I always want the seam away from the camera. Like if we're rendering the object like this, I want where the mesh is gonna unfold. I want that border edge away from us so we don't see it. So I selected an edge in 3D space and it's selected it also in the UV editor. I'm gonna go to the cut and sew UVs here. I'm gonna cut it. You can see it turned it into a darker edge, which means now that is a border edge. And all I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna select all the UVs, not vertices. Remember, in the UV editor, we're playing with UVs, not vertices, okay? We're gonna minimize the cut and sew tool. We're gonna go to unfold. And you know, we have this magic button called unfold and it's supposed to do everything for you. And it does a decent job, but sometimes I like to do it manually. So V means vertical. U means horizontal. So I'll usually unfold vertical first and then horizontal. And then there are my crappy UVs. We have some really cool tools. The one tool I love using is this smooth tool. But before you can use it properly, I go to the option box and I like setting it to UV space. I don't like using world space. When I use the tool, I get better results when I use it in UV space. So when you've set that and closed it, you get like this little kind of sub menu here at the bottom where it says relax. And what relax does, it kind of like just evens the spacing out between everything. And if you keep going, it just kind of collapses until it supernovas on itself. Okay, we don't really use relax too much, but the one thing we do use is this unfold. And what this does is it lets you unfold in a gradient, kind of like
at different levels like this. You're allowed to unfold it until you kind of get the shape that you want, okay? So then once you get something that you like, you can turn on this little checkered board button up here and minimize the outliner or the UV editor again. And you can check your 3D object and see if it's stretching, doing anything, excuse me, weird. All right. And it looks pretty decent, but is this the most optimal way to unwrap this object? No, it's not. The best way, especially for certain objects like this, like cylinders, and even this, it's a cylindrical object, is there is this awesome cylindrical unwrap. And when you select the object and click on that cylindrical unwrap button under the UV tab, which is right here, you get this kind of like special gimbal that shows up, okay? And if you push any other button like WER, it goes away. But as long as you have the cylindrical projection live in your history, you should be able to hit T on the keyboard to bring it back, okay? So if you hit W by accident and it goes away, you can reuse the command and you'll get it back, but you can hit T and it usually brings back the special gimbal, okay? So we're trying to unwrap a cylinder and it gave us this special cylinder kind of gimbal. So what we have to do is kind of orient and rotate the special gimbal to match with the orientation of the cylinder. So to do that, you can see there, well, there's no rotate button, there's no rotate handle, nothing. That's because they expect you to know all this stuff. But if you hit this little, it looks like a T at the corner here. It's kind of, every time I zoom in, it gets smaller and smaller, but I'm just gonna zoom out and you can see it right here. There's this like little T. If you click on it, just left click, and you zoom out, all of a sudden you get your transforms. You get your transform, you get this circle if you click on it, you get your rotation. So now we can rotate it in Z. You can see it right here. We can rotate it 90 degrees and now it's going in the same direction. And if we go back to our UV editor and let's just turn off the texture so we can see what's happening. Look at that. It looks just like the original UVs when we first did it. There's no weird distortion in between from following the contour of this. Everything is nice and straight. If we turn on our texture here and we zoom in, we can see we have our little textures here, but you can see something's wrong. The checkerboard is kind of squashed. So what you can do is you can keep using the tool and you can scale the special locator until you get the right size or as close to it. You could finally, just because you rotated the gimbal, you finally got the object looking right, you can just say, you know what, I'm just gonna do it myself now and I'm just gonna exit the special tool and you can do everything now in the UV editor. So I just right clicked, change to UVs. And now you can hit R in the UV editor and you can squash and stretch it in here, which the tool was doing for you in 3D space anyway. So you can kind of just get it to look as close as you can to it. And that should be it. It looks pretty good. We can scale the whole thing down evenly using the middle, just so it takes up only one UV tile, not like four or five. And you can see all, we're getting a little stretching here, but that's okay because the shape is changing a little bit, but we're getting a little bit of distortion, but not that much. If we want, We should just save this right now. Dumbbell underscore B001. One second. Sorry. Okay, save. Okay. So we could do the same thing. We could unfold vertically, and that way we get it as perfect as we can, and then we could unfold it horizontally. And you could see it does change the shape a little bit. It does change the shape a little bit, so we're not getting as much distortion here. But honestly, I'd rather have that distortion there and be able to paint vertically, okay? So you kind of have to weigh your odds, okay? You can, depending on the object, this object is very simple, but sometimes, especially if you're doing like, let's say a pipe and the pipe is going all over the place, it's best to leave it perfectly, the UVs perfectly straight, just so when they flow nicely. I'll do a small video on the side and I'll upload it for you guys explaining all of this and showing you some extra little tidbits here and there. But okay. So now that we've UV'd this, it's time to UV this bad boy. All right, so this is more of a pain in the butt because it's got a lot of stuff. It's got flat sides, it's got angled sides. So, you know, what do we do here? We could try cylindrical unwrap, and we will, and we'll see what we get. And you can see here we get like this half cylinder now. Before we got a full cylinder, but not a half one. So what we can do is if we hit this red button here and click and hold, we can drag it and it changes the projection. So basically if we left it like this, it's almost like you're projecting the UVs on, from like a card, right? Because it's almost flat. So, but when you grow the cylindrical projection, you're projecting the object from all around, okay? And again, is our projection facing the right way for a cylindrical projection? No. We need to click on that little T, click on the circle, and we're gonna rotate it 90 degrees. And you can see what it's doing to our UVs, all right? As we rotate, you could see how the projection is changing. There you go. Let's see if we make sure we hit negative 90, 90, it doesn't matter. As long as the, so now the cylindrical projection is going in the same direction as our object. And this is what we, and this is what we get. We get all the flat sides. Let's minimize that. We get all the flat sides and some of the weird front sides, okay? So it's not all just like cylindrical project and you're finished. There's a lot of like little things that you'll have to do. So what I like to do is I start breaking the object down, okay? What do I want to project next? I want to take these caps off. And when I mean caps, I mean like flat surfaces on like a cylinder or something, like the ends of something, okay? So I just selected both ends and I'm just going to kind of aim my camera down the kind of almost like an orthographic view. And I'm going to say create UVs based on camera and watch what happens in the UV editor. Now I have those two caps here and they're selected. I'm just going to move them out of the way. And you could see one is blue and one is red. Basically, Maya kind of did this
to make it kind of simple for people to understand. If your UVs are blue, your object, your UVs are facing the right direction. And why you want this is for displacement. Let's say I have a gouge, right? And that gouge is in the blue and the red. So red means the UVs are reversed. They're opposite. So if I paint a gouge on the blue UVs and the gouge is going in, it's taking material out of the object. If I paint that same gouge on the red UVs, what is it going to do? It's not going to make a scratch or an indent. It's going to make a hump because the UVs are flipped. So they're going to do the complete opposite. I think substance painters kind of fix that. It doesn't do that anymore. But like if you were to paint your own maps like ages ago, you would have that problem. And I think it still might be a problem in Mari, but I haven't come across it. But it's always good to just make sure your UVs are always facing the same way. So, and the reason I did that, I'm just going to hide this stuff for a second. So remember what I did. I used the camera projection for UVs based on this angle. So if we look at this, of course, this face you can see in the UV editor is going to be blue because I'm looking right at it, right? But on the other side, from the same angle, I'm actually projecting on the inside, right? Because it's this angle. So we're looking at this shape from the inside. So if I went this way and just ignore the image planes, let's just hide them. Just gonna select them and control H and hide them. So if I selected these here and I did the UVs camera project, what's gonna happen? We're gonna get the opposite because now we're projecting the UVs from this object on the outside, and we're projecting these UVs on the inside because we're looking at the object through here. Just imagine you're looking through it, right? Okay, that's it. The way you can fix this is you could, you know, project both ends separately, or you can, in here, if you select these UVs, sorry, I'm just going to turn this texture off here. If you select these UVs, you can go to transform and somewhere around here, right down here where it says scale, there's this flip. And I usually just flip it horizontally and then my UVs will be the right way. Okay. So these caps are okay now. Let's just leave them. And now we're just left with the rest of the object here. So let's see if we can unfold this and see what happens. So it's super compressed and we can see that by turning on the texture and looking at our object. And which way is it compressing? It's compressing in the UV editor, it's compressing up and down because we can see that this, selecting this is this half. If we wanted to look at the UVs the same way as we see the object in 3D space, what we can do is we can rotate the UVs and we could rotate it manually or under the transform, there's this rotate by whatever angle or degree you want. So I'll just make it 90. And now you can see my UVs are facing the right way. If we scroll down to unfold, we can try unfolding it automatically and we get something like this, but I want to do it manually just so we know what we're doing and how to do UVs properly. So I'm going to unfold it horizontally and you can see now we've done the center. The center UVs look perfect. Now it's just the outside UVs. And the reason these UVs kind of look skewed is our UVs are nice and perfectly and straight, right? But our faces here, what are they doing? If you look at this shape, are the ends perfectly straight? No, they're tapering, right? They're tapering, but our UVs in the viewport are straight. So what we can do here is we can go through, and it's a pain in the butt, but you can do it. We can go through and we're just gonna select all those edges right down the middle, the ones that go right down the middle. So if we go wireframe, we can see now that we've selected all of them. But now what we want to do is we only want to have the ones selected from the ends, not the ones down the middle. We don't want to separate the whole object. So what we're going to do is we're going to hold control and we're going to drag and we're going to deselect the center part, okay? We're going to do that for everything. And you can experiment with how far up into the bevel you should, but usually I'll cut it leaving one, just so we have one supporting edge, just so, because when you cut UVs, it likes to tear a little bit too, just like an unsupported edge loop, okay? And when we get to the end, we see there's no straight edge here. So we'll have to do something like that. We'll have to get creative, because we want that cut to go right to the end. Let's just, and the good thing about this is, especially when objects are like symmetrical like this, you could just do the UVs on half the object, mirror the object, and then stitch the UVs back together, just like stitching the 3D object, okay? I'll do that tonight in a video and I'll show you. Okay, so now I've selected these. I'm gonna go to the cut and sew and I'm just gonna cut them. And you could see one more thing. We did the cylindrical unwrap and you could see here, it didn't make a nice perfect shape. It took a certain face from one end and cut it out from the other, because maybe when we did our rotate of the projection, it wasn't perfectly straight and it cut a little bit out. So what we can do is we can cut this out. And if we go to the top and we select these three, these edges on the inside here, and if we go stitch together A and B, it will move them and it will sew them nicely together. So now that we've, look what I did here. I hit cut, but I forgot to deselect this. So I'm gonna have to select this again and I'm gonna sew this together. And you're like, sir, why did you select edges that weren't cut? Because it doesn't matter. I can hit sew a million times and it's not gonna do anything because these objects are already sewn. They're not separated. It's not gonna do anything to it, okay? All right, so now what we can do is we can go back to unfold. We can try to unfold vertically and then horizontally. And now if we put on our grid and we look at our UVs, they look pretty darn good, okay? We sub-D them, they still look good. We get a little bit of stretching. You can see it right here. You see where the cut is in our UVs, we're getting a little stretching. And that's just because our mesh, when we smooth it, it opens up. So what we can do is we can add an edge loop. Let's just go object, multi-cut. We can add an edge loop at 50%. 50%, and that should hold everything nicely to a degree. So we're not gonna get a lot of stretching. It's not gonna be perfect, but it's gonna be good enough. Another thing you will see is, well, sir, my UVs on my caps and my UVs on the rest of my model are different. They're not the same scale. So Maya's already thought of that. And under, where the hell was it? I don't even remember anymore. It should be under transform. We have, yes, this textile density, okay? Basically what this does, you don't have to remember the fancy name, you just gotta remember where it is. Basically what it does is you set the scale of the UVs you want. Let's say I want the UVs for this to fit perfectly in here. And whatever scale these UVs are, I want everything else to follow the same. So what you can do is you can set the scale of this object like this, select it, and you can say get textile density, and you'll get this number. You'll select the other objects, and if you say set, so now what it's doing is it's changed the UVs of the caps to match the scale of the rest of the dumbbell. Okay. See? All right. You'll notice when I subdivided, I get some pretty bad stretching. And that's just because of my UVs are cut here and I don't have enough supporting edge loops. So what we can do is we can try. Let's turn off the checkered pattern here. And we can try and insert some supporting edge loops. And see if that helps a little bit. Okay. Just get rid of that. There you go. So it helps a little bit. We could start, you know, adding a little bit more edge loops, or what we could do is we could probably stitch the cap a little bit closer to the, we can stitch the caps to the UV editor. Hold on. Okay, where is the actual? Oh, Maya, come on. Okay, why can't I see the UV editor? Good Lord. Let's just close that now. No. Okay. We'll just leave it at that. Oh. Let's just save it. Let's go new scene. Recent. Okay. I don't know why it disappeared. Maya, come on. Got the modeling toolkit. Let's see. Ah, here we go. The UV editor. Okay, so let's just turn this off. Okay. So you can see that I added some extra edge loops, mostly for trying to support the object so when we sub D it, it doesn't tear as much. And you will have to do this depending on if you can get away with the UVs being cut. If you can't, then, you know, it's, you know, you doing UVs, you kind of have to see what works. Do you need, do you want distortion, or do you want, more geometry because you have to reinforce because now your UVs are cut more. All right. It de- it's, you kind of have to play around and see what you can do. You can probably go into the UV editor and try to cut, like sew these back in and see if that's going to work. But I'll let you play around and see what you guys get. Okay. I'm going to save this. We only got half an hour. Good Lord. I'll start with some of you guys that want some one-on-one. Okay. So dumbbell, try to use this video. I'll upload some of the other videos. I also have a substance video on it. You guys can follow along. Yeah. If you guys want next class, I wanted to kind of like, I think next class I'm going to do one-on-one. We'll go over the projects that you want to do. And then you guys can go and go off and create your asset. And the following class we'll do a lighting or something. Okay. We'll probably take the dumbbell or the helmet and we'll create some lights and make it look pretty. Okay. Okay.